Hi everyone, sorry for my absence over the last few weeks. I haven't posted any new videos or anything for a while. I've been working on a 73-minute analysis of H.R. Giger's artwork. It's the first video that I've done, which is a study of an artist's work rather than filmmakers. I've now finished that video, and this video here is going to include a 11 or 12 minute free section of the video for you to watch on YouTube. If you want to see the full video, you can order it on my website. There's a link in the video description below. It covers all kinds of themes to do with Giger. I've read lots and lots of material about the guy and studied lots of books on his work, and it goes into a lot of detail, of course. Also, I've been a bit busy lately because I've got some new editing equipment, a really good fast new PC, and I've been souping that up with some up-to-date software, so hopefully the new software, which is a lot better than my old software, should speed up my editing for future videos and hopefully increase the rate at which I get new videos out. I'd just like to also say thanks to everyone for all your votes in the poll that I posted last month regarding which projects you want to see next. I was already working on the Giger video at the time that I posted that poll, but now that I've got that out the way, I can start working on some of the projects that you guys all voted for. And the leading contenders, the ones that got the most votes, appear to be the Grand Theft Auto 5 video game analysis. I haven't done a video game analysis before, but I think I should be able to do one on that. And the stuff on Alfred Hitchcock and Francis Ford Coppola, a lot of you guys voted for that stuff as well. I've already been doing a lot of work on materials for an Apocalypse Now analysis. So all that stuff should be coming in the near future. Thanks for waiting in the meantime, and I hope you enjoy this free section about Giger's artwork. Until next time, take it easy. The cynical take on human nature that seems to be present in Giger's art has bred some hostile reactions, especially from those who mistakenly perceive themselves to be morally pure. Accusations of indecency and pornography have been common, though I can't personally see how many people would be sexually aroused by his work, given its more grotesque features. It's definitely to Giger's credit that he stuck to his guns throughout most of his career, only occasionally compromising his commercially contracted work, such as reportedly airbrushing out a penis near the mouth in this album cover. Featured in the H.R. Giger book are a series of crude works that appear to be his response to certain critics who had made allegations of indecency in his work. His educational charts offer text instructions to the viewer about how to deny the sexual abuse of children if they come across it, how incest is good for families because it bonds the family together, and they include allusions to sexual abuse within religious institutions. One of them even includes the statement, "Blessed by the bishop." The charts are ridiculously over the top and may initially seem very crude, but it's also clever in a way. Giger was smart enough to know that when the profanity accusations come flying, the act of watering down one's art in response is an act of intellectual defeat, a sort of confirmation that the accusations were probably true. But Giger's opposite response of giving the critics the profanity they want to see, and then some, puts his usual work into a more rational context. It lets the viewer know that, if he were inclined, Giger's usual artwork could have been made a lot more offensive. It also provides a bit of a laugh for other viewers who get the anti-critic joke. Rather than water down the concepts in his work, it appears that as Giger's career progressed, he simply became more aesthetically efficient at masking over the unpleasant themes. Sure, his early works do sometimes come off as being like the pornographic scribblings of some deviant, horny teenager, or even the sexual fantasies of a serial killer, but the aesthetic intricacy and surrealistic beauty that he later introduced had a similar effect to Picasso's Cubism. In Cubism, the strange geometry and abnormal plays of light and colour give the viewer something interesting and beautiful upon initial exposure, but as the viewer studies the image, the figures and scenarios in which they're engaged slowly become recognisable. And this is especially powerful with Giger because, rather than using the cartoonish flat designs of Cubism, his works instead use what could perhaps be called blendism. things melting and melding into each other to become one big messy whole. The fact that Giger's blendism retains a certain amount of photorealism in terms of textures and light also brings an interesting contrast. His art is both incredibly realistic and unrealistic simultaneously. It makes physical that which is usually only in the deeper recesses of the mind, hence Giger wasn't just a painter, he sculpted a hell of a lot too. And this plays into Giger's general theme of suppressed sexual instincts. What is hiding beneath the surface aesthetics are things which some viewers may consciously deny, yet subconsciously feel as they view his work. It also gives the viewer a sense of responsibility for their own perception of the painting, as if the perceiving of phalluses and vaginas and sexual acts are merely projections of the viewer's own subconscious sexual thoughts. And that's a double-edged approach. It gives Giger plausible deniability, yet it also raises a truth about what lies in our own minds. The fact that we can see the things that he intended, even though they are severely distorted, shows that those things are in our minds anyway. This fits nicely into Giger's efforts to have us explore our darker selves in full light. On page 122 of the H.R. Giger book is printed a letter sent to the artist by art curator Michel Favaz, and it finishes with this insightful summary. Quote, "Those who characterize your works as obscene deliberately place them in an unsuitable context. It is an inappropriate interpretation or projection for which they alone are responsible. They are the ones who misview the portrayed relationships. Therefore, it is their perceptions that are obscene and not your works." End quote. For the most part, I'm in agreement with Favaz's point. Elsewhere, Giger has talked about repression and denial. He has stated that women's objections to their husbands having Playboy magazines and centerfolds on display is simply down to their fear of competition. And he even stated that most homes are decorated boringly because the women of the house tend to choose the decor. There are also other patterns in his work itself that appear to communicate a theme of human beings living in denial of their darker stages. One thing that I found confusing for a while was the frequent occurrence of figures that seem to be splitting into two or merging into one, giving the weird impression of people having sex with themselves. And I think a plausible interpretation of this is that some of his work alludes to self-masturbation, which is a particularly touchy social taboo still to this day. Self-stimulation is a very private activity generally. People proudly talk about their sexual encounters with others, but they hardly ever talk about their own self-stimulation. We pretend like it doesn't happen, yet the huge global markets for pornography, which in most cases are basically masturbation aids, prove just how important self-stimulation is to most people. Masturbation is probably engaged in a lot more often than sex itself. Take this image from which sprang the phallic head creature design eventually used in the film Alien. The figure is holding its own erect phallus and has a phallus-shaped head. Maybe I'm projecting here, but the whole thing looks like a masturbation metaphor. And it seems like there's a bit of visual wordplay going on too. We often refer to the tip of the penis as the head, and heads and penises are cross-symbolized with each other in Giger's artwork. The private use of sex toys and erotic clothing and harnesses also pop up from time to time in Giger's art. And perhaps this is one reason why there's a fusion of flesh with buckles, plastic, leather, and machine mechanisms. Like with the pornography masturbation industry, the incorporation of inanimate objects in sex acts is evident in the mass production, distribution and purchasing of sex toys and erotic clothing and other devices like binds, gimp masks and handcuffs. It's a whole industry. So we could say that Giger is basically acknowledging aspects of sexuality that are present in the personal lives of many respectable, normal people. But again, these are facets of human behaviour that we collectively avoid talking about. How many people have accidentally found pornography or sex toys among the private belongings of their friends or family members? A hilarious example of this that I experienced was that when I shot my short fiction film, The Sex Game, which was set in a brothel, I ordered several erotic bondage items to be used as costumes and props for characters in the film. They were fairly expensive, not the types of things that people buy second hand, of course. So after the shoot was over, I stored them all in a bin bag in case I ever decided to make another movie that would require the same props. Some of them did end up being fused into the monster costumes of my feature film Turn in Your Grave years later. But during the interim, I moved into an apartment with a girl I was seeing at the time. Her parents helped us move into the flat, and afterwards we noticed that her father had slightly opened all of the bin bags so we could tell what room to put each bag in. And he had quietly placed the bag of leather costumes, whips, etc. in our bedroom and not said a word to either of us. And we had a really good laugh about the fact that he probably visualised us engaged in all manner of sex game activities, and that if he'd just cracked a joke about it, then we could have told him the truth. And what was even funnier was that my girlfriend revealed that she had on occasion found her parents' own private stores of sex game equipment. Welcome to the weird world of sexual activity denial. It's possible that this denial facet in sexual psychology is deliberately hinted at in Giger's work as well. Most of the characters, for lack of a better word, have their eyes closed. With the babies, that's understandable on a simple physical level, but it's also true with most of the adult characters. They either have their eyes closed or covered by some sort of fleshy surface, or the eyes are connected to machine-like probes. In this picture, which is ironically called The Witnesses, all of the characters' eyes are closed as they hold phallic objects in their hands. How can they be witnesses if their eyes are closed? This stuff might be, in some instances, a crossover with the fact that babies and embryos have their eyes closed most of the time, but it does seem to tie in with the psychological denial factor too, blind lust, so to speak. And there's a big difference between men and women in this respect too. Giger's art hardly ever shows men's eyes open, and in many examples, the men, or even babies, are wearing what appear to be welding goggles, shades, or pilot's goggles, another type of blindness and a means of preventing eye contact. The pilot metaphors extend to the cross-symbolism between gas masks and umbilical cords. In this example, a figure seems to be both baby and mother rolled into one. The umbilical gas mask cord is linked to the same figure's own stomach. But generally, the blind lust and denial stuff seems to apply mostly to the men in Giger's work. Women, on the other hand, often have their eyes prominently open. Perhaps Giger is suggesting that women are more acutely aware of the darker side of human sexuality, being that they tend to be the targets of horny men and thus need to be more aware of it. Incidentally, I wonder if the term horny comes from the religious notion of sexual desire being associated with evil, being that Satan has horns. It probably is. And a last point about all this sexual stuff, Giger's artwork appears to be almost exclusively about phallic, and occasionally oral, sex. Anal sex and anuses in general are very prominent in some people's sexual psychology, but not in Giger's work. So despite all of the in-your-face sexuality in his paintings, maybe he didn't want to go there. Now, I could be clutching at Freudian straws with these interpretations that Giger is making a statement about human beings in denial of their own sexual urges, but this picture I think is quite overt about the issue of identity. Giger's self-portrait appears to be communicating that either it's impossible for him or any other person to examine themselves objectively, or that to do so is the emotional equivalent of painful or even life-threatening self-mutilation.